Hey there, students. We're going to be covering chapter one this week, which looks like Kai Erickson's piece on the sociology of deviance. And we're going to be looking at how deviance is functional, and we'll also be considering how many of the institutions that are enforcing, and managing deviance and norms and everything else, how they're oftentimes reinforcing these ideas and oftentimes creating a self-fulfilling prophecy. So we'll get into that for this chapter. So when looking at Kai Erickson's piece this week entitled The Sociology of Deviance, his biggest ideas in this piece that are found look at some of the functions of deviance. And this is again coming from a functionalist perspective, right? That says overall our systems are working, but you have to have, they essentially see deviance as very normative, that you find deviance in every single culture, and thus deviance must be there to serve a particular function. So some of the functions that Kai outlined in this week's readings look at how deviance set boundaries for society. Oftentimes, some of our biggest boundaries are set by the law, right? So the law sets a distinct line. This is what you should not do. And it's a pretty black and white thing, right? Deviance, that's law and crime, but deviance, you'll see a lot more gray area because, again, deviance is anything that varies from the norm. And so the lines around deviance or boundaries around deviance aren't as clear as the lines around law, but that doesn't still mean that it sets boundaries for what's acceptable. We also will look at how deviance will boost your cohesion, group solidarity, and integration. If we look at some of the protests that have been happening, that was a response to what protesters deemed as unlawful or unjust behaviors by law enforcement. But we can see how, having these protests all over the world has created cohesion amongst the people, in them, and even so amongst, law enforcement as well. And you really see these in-group and out-group dynamics, where, you see blue lines and you see black lives or blue lives, black lives, right? And we see it. I mean, this has become almost like a cultural war. But we can look at how each group has been kind of solidified, and maybe their movements have even gotten larger, I would contend. Another function of deviance is, one of the basic functions is it provides jobs for people. And so if you look at the criminal justice system, if you look at the medical system, people in rehab or people working in rehab, like all of these jobs that are created are really, really important, and they help society function. They feed into the economy and things like that. Lastly, social change. And so in order to have any sort of social change within a particular culture, you have to have some sort of deviance. So just reminding you of some of the examples throughout our history of social injustice and movements around those ideas. If we didn't have people like MLK and Rosa Parks and Ida B. Wells and all of these other people who were shining light on these ideas and in fact breaking the law in order to produce social change. And so that's really important. You have to have that type of stuff in order for societies to change. So an important idea within this piece is that deviance is dependent on the social context. Your behavior within one setting might be looked at deviant, where in another setting it wouldn't. So for instance, if you wear your bathing suit to class, right, that's going to be looked at as deviant. It's very much so outside of the norm. If you were wearing that bathing suit to the beach, yeah, totally appropriate, right? The language you use amongst your friends might be very different than the language you use amongst your grandparents. And this is just that idea of within a social context, even within a family, These boundaries are different. I've talked to my daughter about this type of stuff where I had to tell her one time, it's not okay for you to tell other people what mommy and daddy are talking about, essentially behind their back. But she did that one time. She told a friend that, I had been talking with my husband about her sister who was posting racist stuff online. And she was a little girl at the time, and you think, and then I had to have this conversation about, okay, what we talk about within our family, it's not okay to go ahead and tell other people. And so it's really important for you to think about the context. You might use certain language in your home, or you might, know it's okay to act this way or something like that when, like, in a different setting or a different institution, you would be judged much more harshly. So that was an important idea that Kai wanted to include. So the first kind of dimension within Kai's piece that we'll be looking at will be how communities set boundaries. And boundaries are very much learned through the socialization process. And if you've never taken an intro class before, the socialization process is this everyday process in which we learn attitudes and values and norms of a particular culture, right? And you have agents of socialization. These are people like your parents, schooling, the media, religion, right? All of these institutions have an impact on who you become and like how you learn these values and ideas and things like that. So generally, they're enforced by official members or agents within that particular institution. And so if you, for instance, kind of step over a boundary when it comes to something at school, maybe the principal will be called. If it's serious enough, they'll call, outside agents to come. And generally, what we'll see in terms of like law and the crime is that there's really a dramatization that takes place. And these are all actions to maintain those boundaries, right? In this picture here, you have a young man who's put in handcuffs. There's quite a few law enforcement around him for one person. You have to imagine that when this kind of stuff happens within neighborhoods, I know if it was happening in my neighborhood, I would definitely be watching, right? People are watching from their windows, they're watching from the media, who is also there, right? They're really amplifying this process, right? You'll see this continued. You'll see this young man walk into the courtroom, and it's dramatized now. He's out of his, individual clothes, and he's into the costume of those institutions. So the prison garb, whatever it's stripes or orange or whatever, but all of this is to use to kind of degrade you. It's gross, right? You're wearing other people's clothes, other people's underwear. I don't think a lot of people realize that sometimes. But it's this really dramatization between us versus them. Like they are the bad guys. We're not like them, right? And we see it really amplified within the public and really dramatized. And these processes are really used to send messages to people, and it really gives us kind of that the boundary maintenance, right? What is okay? Is it okay to be a little bit deviant? How much are we going to allow? How much is gonna be tolerated? And I think we saw a lot of examples of that with watching the protests in the last couple years. Where we are constantly told, okay, well, peaceful protest is okay. The minute someone does something out of the norm, that's when it's not tolerated. But we oftentimes aren't seeing like the big picture, right? Was there kind of pushback by the moral entrepreneurs, who are we would call law enforcement? How did that impact this whole kind of interaction and dynamic? So there's a lot to think about in this, but I want you to remember that a lot of this is creating kind of a symbolic set of parentheses. That's what Kai called it, in terms of what's acceptable within this particular community. It's making a statement about the nature and place of its boundaries, and how much will be tolerated, right? And this idea is all associated with like really guarding the cultural integrity of the community. And as we've discussed in previous slides and lectures, in terms of this idea of community setting boundaries, we know that the boundaries are fluid. They are always changing, but you oftentimes have to have deviance in order for that change. And so it's really interesting in terms of like civil rights, if we look at LGBT issues or racial rights, you know, we oftentimes see America hold people up like Martin Luther King and Harvey Milk within the gay community. And they said, you know, these are people that should be held up because, you know, they did it the right way, right? They MLK didn't use any type of violence. But I want you to also, from a kind of a social conflict perspective, to think about, well, you know, the Black community has had violence inflicted on them since the beginning of this country and slavery and all the other atrocious things. But the second that a Black person fights back, that would be considered, you know, a transgression. And again, it's the people in power who get to decide that, right? So as we hold up people like MLK and looking at how, you know, Blacks have gained some rights in the last 150 years, we might also consider, you know, what that means. And so even though MLK is held up as doing it right, he was still another Black man murdered, right? So it's important to kind of look at this critically and think about, you know, how this influences people's behaviors, right? Because essentially they're really trying to kind of preserve the stability of social life. You know, they're always something that are, you know, changing, and things that might change or influence change would be like shifts in moods and attitudes. And we saw that with kind of some of the protests. A change in leadership could have a huge influence. Sometimes it has to do with, you know, something happening in a particular community as an ongoing process of social change. And so, you know, and sometimes it's just looking at things from new models. And so we can look at drug addiction, or we can look at it as a crime. We can look at it as an addiction. You know, we can look at drugs as a crime. We can look at it as an addiction. And of course, our approach to changing it will have very significant influences in how, you know, change that might happen. So next, we're going to talk about the role of institutions in maintaining these boundaries. And there are various ways in which institutions do this. If we're looking at things like the criminal justice system, we might consider, for instance, the revolving door. I'm not sure if many of you know this, but 80% of our people incarcerated will recidivate, which means they will be reincarcerated sometime within the next 5 years. And so we have to create an understanding is that when people enter into the system, the likelihood that they remain in the system is very, very high. And we want to look at some of the reasons for that. And some of the reasons for that are also some of the reasons in which institutions play a role in this kind of boundary maintenance and kind of deviance amplification. So a lot of the times, you know, within prisons, for instance, you have a gathering of many marginalized groups together. You know, prison in America is a very dangerous place, and oftentimes people will bind together out of necessity and out of protection. And so you might see someone who's never engaged in gang activity join a gang out of protection and maybe take some of that gang affiliation with him when he leaves. We might also look at how mass incarceration and the role of institutions work to reinforce a sense of alienation from the rest of society. You know, and I want to, you know, remind you guys that this is not this way everywhere. Not every country functions this way. But we really cut people off from the outside world, right? Oftentimes, they are completely alienated, they are exploited. Like, even if you want to make a phone call, you're going to pay 10 times as much as what someone from the outside pays. There's not a lot, sometimes they will move you across, the state where you're away from your family, or they'll have to travel 4 hours to come see you every weekend. And I mean, these are people's children that, come see them. And so, if not just for the person incarcerated, but also consider the factors for the family, and how it works to really break those social ties, that can be seen within from a parental standpoint, or other familial or types of relationships. So it reinforces that sense of alienation from the rest of society. Also, we know it creates a stigma. So many people that end up in these institutions, they will have to mark that they're a convicted felon. It's very hard to get grants to go back to school. You can no longer get Section 8. And there's just the idea that people who have not had these experiences are scared of people like this. They go, "Oh my gosh, you must be some awful person. You were in prison." And we go, "Oh, I don't want to hang out with you," or "You're not my kind of person." So these are all kind of ideas to remember. The other thing is that these are rites of transition. So as you go into these systems, you go through what are known as degradation ceremonies, and these are ceremonies in which you are degraded, right? So you are again putting, oftentimes having to do like cavity searches, put in the prison garb. You are kind of stripped of all of your identity. Your head might be shaved, right, to make you kind of look like everybody else. But what's important is that we do all of these things to really strip people of who they are and their identities. And then when they get out of prison, we don't do anything to kind of build them back up. And that's a really important idea in terms of like psychology and the, what we're actually doing, what this stigma is doing to people and kind of chipping away at their own self-worth and identities. And we see these really ceremony, we see them institutionalized in the ceremonies, right? So for instance, the courtroom drama, right? The how many times have you seen the defendant walk in handcuffs, in his prison garb, right? We see it over and over, and it's dramatized. We see these things made into movies. We see it in the news. I mean, you see it all the time. I'm actually watching a Netflix show and I saw it last night. I mean, it's happening all the time. And so what ends up happening is oftentimes this can become a self-fulfilling prophecy because, these are the people that law enforcement, police officers, and even people in the community will continually suspect for crimes because of their past, right? When, someone goes, "Oh my gosh, there was a robbery in this neighborhood," and everyone goes, "Oh, have you looked at Joe? Joe just got out of prison," And you go, and then the police go to Joe's, and then they find out, I don't know, as a he's been smoking pot, and he lives in a state where he's not allowed to smoke pot, and that is a violation of his parole. And it's just it's and this is the type of stuff that happens all the time. Or someone didn't show up for a meeting, or whatever it is. And so, this is just to create an understanding of like how institutions play a role in kind of perpetuating deviant behavior. And all of these kind of ceremonies and things that we were talking about in the previous slide will lead to what we know as a self-fulfilling prophecy. And this is the idea that individuals will come to internalize the way they perceive other people see them, right? And this doesn't just happen for deviants or people that have been previously incarcerated. We are constantly doing this, and this is known as Cooley's a looking glass self in sociology. And what he said was we continually kind of envision how others are seeing us. We make an idea about that, and then we internalize that idea. So, you know, you might go, oh, well, my boss has given me, I don't know, employee of the month 3 days in a, or 3 months in a row. I must be doing a fantastic job, right? I am a fantastic employee. Or the opposite happening, right? And maybe that person just thinks you're cute. I don't know. But whether it's true or not, it creates a self-fulfilling prophecy or a belief that, you know, I can't really change. I must be this really bad person, right? It's expressed all the time, right? I didn't even do anything, and now I'm sitting here and the police are at my door. For, you know, something else somebody else did. And again, this can start making people feel like they may not have an option. So I have a short video, I think it's about 10 minutes, and this looks at Jane Elliott. And it made it look like a little bit outside of what we're talking about, but this was a classroom in which Jane Elliott gave kind of these pseudo identities to her students. And she found within just a few minutes, they started internalizing their roles. As someone who was kind of subjugated in the classroom, or someone who was kind of identified as being a dominant identity. And it's really amazing how fast these kids start kind of turning on each other and behaving badly, and how quickly that self-fulfilling prophecy plays out. So I hope you enjoy this. It's a really important film or kind of experiment in sociology. All right, so the next chapter we're going to be looking at is entitled Applying an Integrated Typology of Deviance to Middle-Class Norms by Hackard and Hackard. Here we're going to be considering other definitions of deviance outside that of the social misfit, right? And it's really important to consider that in terms of looking at disciplines, criminology, which is also a class that I teach here at Green River, criminology has really grown in the last 100 years. And part of the reason for that is because its definitions, as we've talked about, are very clear. The boundaries are right there written down, right? But in terms of deviance, there's a lot more ambiguity. There's a lot more gray area. You know, what's considered deviant might be even positive, what's known as positive deviance, and we'll talk about that, or, you know, going outside of the norm in a positive way. So, you know, if you walked into class and I gave everybody a $100 bill, that would be deviant. It would be outside the norm, but, you know, deviant in a way that's looked at from a positive perspective. So within the two disciplines, there's no consensus of what deviance actually is. But again, crime is a lot more manageable and easier to study because those lines and boundaries are a lot more clear and have been codified into law. So what's really important for you as students to understand is that really there's no clear definition of what deviance is. And like we said, criminology, because that line in the law is, you know, so clear and right there, it's easier to study. And there's more ambiguity around what deviance actually is. So, you know, if we look at deviance from various kind of viewpoints, we can see that, you know, a lot of these definitions have been rejected completely. Or don't really necessarily follow logic and like sequence. So for instance, if we look at the absolutist model that sees very much, you know, deviance as being black and white, as being moral or immoral, we recognize that, you know, across social groups and across time, you know, that model doesn't hold up. We talked about how murder, you know, we can look at it from a self-defense, and in self-defense, many people will never look at you as a deviant for, you know, shooting someone who breaks into your house or something else. There's also some clear problems looking at it from a statistical model. And the idea around the statistical model is it would be looking at attitudes, you know, they look at deviance as attitudes and behaviors that are rare, but also consider that there are behaviors that aren't rare that are still considered deviant. in. So things like adultery, like excessive drinking, drug use, lying, these are pretty common actually, DUIs. And so, the idea around that is, these aren't statistically rare. These are things that are happening all the time. And so using that model doesn't follow logic either. We also have normative definitions that focus, again, mostly on the violation or norm violations. It's important to think about what's considered normative or objectivist, again, is focusing on those norm violations. Some scholars simply define deviance as a behavior that violates rules or normative expectations, what's considered normative. But when we look at, or normal, but when we look at other dimensions, we might consider what's known as positive deviance. And positive deviance is going outside of the norm in a positive way. So this goes outside of that normative perspective of deviance to look at things like, behavior that is positively evaluated but still outside of the norm. So when we think of the ABCs of, deviance, we might look at, what's an attitude that is positively evaluated, that's deviant. So we might look at like someone like Bill Gates who gives a lot of his fortune away. Most of us look at it as really great. This isn't what the majority of the uber rich are doing though, but it's definitely positively evaluated. So the whole idea here is within the discipline, there's no consensus of what deviance is. Crime is much more clearer to define because of those lines and boundaries that have been created. And this creates a real problem for us as a discipline because we don't even have consensus of what deviance actually is. And so, if there were parts of so far that seemed a little murky, it's because it is. And so, that's just something that we have to take on as we consider all of this. So, from the perspective of Hecker and Hecker, based on what we talked about, based on these ideas that, there's really no clear definition of deviance, they talked about how we can look at it like really differently. So traditionally, deviance has been looked at looking at the framework of negative deviance or, something that somebody did that was bad. But we'll also look at positive behavior that gains either a positive reaction or a negative reaction. And so you'll start to realize that this stuff is a lot more complex than what you start to, what you initially like think about. So the first one I want to talk about is positive deviance overall. And again, this is someone who's going outside of the norm to do something good. Let's think of like historically people like saints, right? They're revered and held up for, giving away their fortunes or, living a life of solitude or whatever it is. But, someone who's also extremely physical attractive would be considered deviant. Like someone, I don't know, the celebrity status or something like that, they're held to a whole nother kind of like level, right? We also see things like rape busting. And this is a type of positive deviance that might look bad. So you go, what would this be? The definition given from the book is an overconformity that leads to negative reactions. So for instance, students that are like trying to be teachers' pets are oftentimes rejected by peers. They're gifted in some way, maybe like in terms of intellect or something. They oftentimes, are doing really well in their schoolwork, but socially they might, face some kind of sanctions for that. We know that, really attractive people are sometimes kind of slighted by those of the same sex, for whatever reason. Maybe they're jealous or whatever. We see blondes as being stereotyped. This one's kind of a push, but the book or the reading this week talks about how blondes would be a form of rape busting because they are overconforming to Eurocentric standards of beauty. And so I don't think your traditional blonde would be this, but maybe someone like a Pam Anderson type person, archetyped is what we would call it. But someone who, maybe has a lot of plastic surgery to maybe build this ideal look. We know that there's a woman who tried to turn herself into the human Barbie. Again, her appearances are outside of the norm, and she might take some, you know, negative reaction for what she has done. In terms of negative deviance, we might also look at how it's looked at very differently. So deviance amplification comes when, you know, certain people historically are kind of held up by the culture, and they were maybe, you know, someone like Robin Hood, Billy the Kid, Al Capone, Bonnie and Clyde is mentioned here. You know, these are people who we've, you know, Scarface, we've come to really admire them for their deviance. And that's kind of an interesting reaction, right? We're like, you guys, you know, Bonnie and Clyde, you're robbing banks. And, but there was something glamorous about them. They didn't fit into this kind of stereotypical bank robbers. Cause for one, Bonnie was there, right? And she, you know, and they were like this cute couple and they had fashion, and so it's kind of interesting, right? But we can see how even their negative behavior could have gotten more of a positive response. And then again, you know, when it comes to negative deviance, that's the one that's kind of stereotypical, right? It's like deviance that is looked at upon negatively, you know, people like serial killers, but even serial killers can kind of be put in that admiration. Like, we love studying them, we love looking at them. You know, someone like Ted Bundy, I think, kind of got that. He might be more of that deviant amplification. So sometimes, you know, I think it matters who you are, right? It matters what you look like. I think, you know, Ted Bundy, he was known to be very attractive. You know, women were, he got married in prison. Women were writing him and telling him how sexy he was. So again, this looks at how, you know, our reactions to deviance. And audiences will react differently. You know, so for instance, that, you know, student who is maybe really gifted, his teacher might look at him as positive, you know, have a positive reaction, but his classmates may not. So we can see that this, you know, shifts and changes, you know, significantly. Right. And we also think about, you know, how we come to, like, worship some of these people as well. But again, this gives us more of a framework to look at this a little bit more critically and look at this more from that reactionist perspective, right? That deviance, there's nothing inherent in it itself. It has to do with the reaction of the society. So when it comes to looking at these normative expectations, we have to really consider the context of the time or the kind of the social environment, the historical time that these people are living in. And again, the response to deviance can be both normative and positive. And so here we have someone like Angelina Jolie. I'm not sure if all of you know this, but years before, probably, this picture was taken when she was first coming out as a, you know, an actress or a celebrity. She actually made out with her brother on camera. You can Google it. I know, right? And it's really interesting because this is such a taboo thing, right? Yeah, it's just very different. But we have to think about, you know, why we've, you know, pretty much forgotten about that act, right? Who is she? Well, she's a famous celebrity. She's been in many movies, big time movies. She's, you know, deemed to be ridiculously beautiful. She was married to the man who was also considered ridiculously beautiful. And you have to understand, you know, how we come to worship celebrities, right? That matters, right? With form, our new form of idol worship. And so, you know, some of these behaviors that they, you know, some of this stuff could have, like, ruined, like, a normal person, you know, a regular person's, I don't like to say normal, I'm sorry, I keep doing that. But, like, you know, if I did that and I got around Green River, I mean, it could be a really big deal. But again, we see that, you know, that kind of reaction was overlooked, right? So again, it depends on the relative power of the individual as well as the social audience. So in terms of this reading, Heckard and Heckard were really Exploring predominant middle class norms in the US. And again, norms are a belief shared by some extent by the members of a social unit as to what is considered appropriate or what ought to be. And Heckert and Heckert make the argument that middle class norms really encompass the ideal or idealized forms of our values, right? Some examples of middle class forms that they outline look at things like the things that, you know, that middle class people value are things like achievement and success. In America, we see a heightened kind of emphasis on individualism or individual rights, activity and work, being, you know, efficiency, practicality, science, technology, material comfort, humanitarianism, freedom, democracy, equality, racism, interesting one, and group superiority. And so as we look at this, it's really important to take a step back and recognize that middle class values are really embedded or influenced by the capitalistic system, right? So many of these ideas here, material comfort, working hard, individualism, individual rights, right? All of that is very much, you know, a product of capitalism. We also can see the influence of, you know, the Bill of Rights, and kind of like the main tenets of the country. And so that, you know, is really interesting. You know, when I taught this class in person a couple of years ago, talking about racism as a middle class value, that was a hard one to explain. And sadly, with these past year or two, it's been easier to see how certain groups are still very much, you know, using these as explanations and trying to maintain white supremacy. So just to recap some of these main ideas outlined in this week's reading, we have negative deviance, which is kind of that stereotypical, you know, some kind of bad behavior with a reaction that is also bad. Then we have deviance admiration, right? It's where, you know, there's a bad behavior, but it's actually positively evaluated. So, you know, just giving you some more examples of these types of things, we might look at, you know, how, and if you go into this week's reading, you have all these in table 2.1, you have all of these classifications of middle class deviance and negative deviance in table 2.2. But just to give you some examples of this, you know, if we look at the American Revolution, that was a form of negative deviance that had a positive evaluation. Right. And again, we really like that kind of rogue idea of the American Revolutionary, high levels of patriotism, things like that. We also might look at, you know, something like telling a white lie as being tactful. And you can look at, again, you can look at some of these examples in the tables, and I would urge you to kind of play around with them a little bit more. And so like that hyper patriotism could very much be looked at as revered by certain groups. And then next we'll look at rape. So the other side of Heckert and Heckert's argument looked at rape busting and positive deviance. Again, positive deviance is going outside of the norm, but doing something that is positively evaluated. Right, and rate busting is a negative reaction to over conformity, like kind of that nerd stereotype, and the reactions can obviously differ from group to group. Positive deviance, again, over conformity that is positively evaluated. So for instance, in terms of other forms of rate busting, we might look at you know, certain religious groups that are looked at as like super conservative are sometimes shunned by the broader society. So again, they have this over conformity, but people might look at them as weird or over religious. Workaholics would be another one who are over conformists. They're, you know, the boss might love them, but their colleagues might see them as a kiss ass or a brown noser or whatever. And so there's all different types that we can look at from these two different tables here. And I, in the next slide, I have that pasted out. So here's that table that I was talking about in terms of the classification of middle class norms. And it is really interesting to kind of look at these. So for instance, this first one looks at group loyalty. Under negative deviance, they have apostasy. Another, I had to look that word up. Another example of apostasy would be treason, right? So you have so much loyalty to the group. Negative deviance would be you were treasonous, right? You did something to you know, negate that trust. Deviance amplification in terms of group loyalty would look at the rebellion, right? How we hold you know, certain individuals as ultra patriotic. You know, they love that loyalty, so they're admired for that, as seen in like the American Revolution. In terms of rape busting, we would look at people who are fanatically patriotic, right? These are who are known as super patriots, you know, just that, or people maybe in the NRA would also be considered, you know, this type of thing. Lastly, positive deviance, and there's some overlap with all of this, so you know, sociology is not always clear cut. But when it comes to positive deviance, we might look at someone like a martyr or someone who is willing to die, or a soldier. They were altruistic, right? They gave their life for this particular cause or for America, or you know, hopefully that makes sense. So hopefully you get an understanding in terms of, again, Heckert and Heckert were looking at how, you know, this deviance and our reactions to it is really based on the middle class and the middle class norms. And so if you have any questions this week, feel free to reach out to me. I'm happy to go into this into more detail, and have a wonderful week. I will see you soon.